Would you stand with me for the word of God? This may be the only time you move. I want to invite you to open your Bibles with me, and I'm going to attempt to take you along with myself in a few conversations that Jesus had along the way under the heading of Have a Little Talk with Jesus. And I want to look tonight at the biggest talk that Jesus had in these little talks. John chapter 3, beginning at verse number 1. Hear the word of God. As Jesus will lead Nicodemus out of the night into the light. Now there was a man, a Pharisee, named Nicodemus, a member of the Jewish ruling council. He came to Jesus at night and said, "Rabbi, we know you are a teacher who has come from God, for no one could perform the miraculous signs you're doing if God were not with him." In reply, Jesus declared, "I tell you the truth, no one can see the kingdom of God unless he is born again." How can a man be born when he is old? Surely he cannot enter a second time into his mother's womb to be born. Jesus answered, "I tell you the truth, no one can enter the kingdom of God unless he is born of water and the Spirit. Flesh gives birth to flesh, but the Spirit gives birth to spirit. You should not be surprised at my saying, you must be born again. The wind blows wherever it pleases. You hear its sound, but you cannot tell where it comes from or where it's going. So it is with everyone born of the Spirit." How can this be? Out of the night into the light. You may be seated. There's something about night that focuses the attention. The night had not given way to the next morning, April 18th. The phone rang in our house. My mother answered it. It was night. I heard muffled tones. I heard a sigh. She walked around the corner into the room of my older brother that I grew up with, sat on the end of the bed, and said, "Your father just died." That was April the 19th, 1972. I remembered it because it happened at night. A ghost had been seen walking the parapet of the Elsinore Castle. The friends of the Prince of Denmark of Hamlet said, "You may not want to go tracing after that ghost. We believe it's the apparition of your father." He didn't listen. He did it. And the greatest play ever written was born. And that setting took place at night. Books have been written about the night scenes. People who enjoy poetry know something about the backdrop of writing in the night. Night focuses the attention. It awakens the imagination. It stirs our creativity. You hear a thud in the day, it doesn't do anything to you, but let it happen at night. A phone can go ringing at 2 o'clock p.m. You might listen to it, give no attention to answering it. But 2 a.m., you reach for it and pray that the person at the other end is having a good morning. There's something that grabs our attention when it comes to night. And Nicodemus, he too falls into the category of persons who make their way, in this case, in the city of David at night. Nicodemus makes his way at night. Maybe his nickname is Nick at Night. I don't know. Because each time you meet Nicodemus in John chapter 3, John chapter 7, John chapter 19, it's always underscored the one who came at night. This imposing figure who makes his way into these small huts in the city of David to come in with probably his Pharisaical garb, I do not know, but he comes to inquire at night. Speculation has been raised. Everybody in here, when I read this, if you've been around the church for any minute, look like some of you have been around, you knew some of the wordings and the language of this story. It brought back fond memories, and even you in your own interpretations have been asking, why did Nick come to Jesus at night? It could have been that he didn't want to be seen. That is a good possibility, particularly since Jesus in the previous chapter had made this declaration that the temple that had been built would be destroyed and then raised again on the third day. You might not want to be seen with that person. You see, it may not mean much to us, but to those whose lives were attached to that temple, he was striking at the very foundation of their existence. I don't know why he went at night. Maybe, I would like to believe, it's because night's a good time to talk to Jesus. Most of us, at some time or another, when we have not been able to sleep, we found ourselves too where we turn aside and we talk to God at night. And the conversation that Nicodemus and Jesus had was of interest. It used some language that poses complexity to the intellectual mind at night. Things like born again. We hear this in the political arena. We often hear people say, this is the born again, the evangelical, and we assume that there's something political attached to this. This is not political partying here. This is not sparring for a party. Jesus is talking about something that happens. Some of your translation reads born again, some born above, born anew. What is it? Well, Nicodemus made his way at night to come and visit Jesus. And he came on the grounds of misunderstanding. He came to investigate Jesus rather than to worship him. And tonight, when you come to Christ, you ought to come out of adoration and not merely investigation. He was a part of a council. He met with the 70 group of people who run the religious center. And Nick says it this way, in a very loving, warm way, I assume, Rabbi, we know that from God you have come as a teacher. For no one can do what you have done except God be with him. The we speaks of the religious establishment who've been keeping record to discover who is this new neophyte who's come to town. This charismatic leader performing miracles on one day, teaching on another day, healing on another day. Who is he? We have come not just to investigate you. We investigated John the Baptizer. He's the one that gave direction to where you really could be found. Behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. And we know that from God you have come and that you are a teacher. For no one can do what you do except God be with them. You notice that he called them rabbi? They had three levels of titles in that day. Rab, rabbi, and rabbon. If you would squeeze that into university language, B.A., M.A., Ph.D. You know what Nicodemus was saying to Jesus? We know that you're more than a B.A. But we know you're not quite a Ph.D. because we give that degree out. But we will say that you are M.A. come from God. And he didn't give him Rabbon because that would have put Jesus above the Pharisee. And by saying that you are just rabbi, that kept him at least on the same playing field religiously as Nicodemus was. And the mistake that Nick made that night is that he misinterpreted whom he was talking to. And he came on the level of investigation. Some of us have come here tonight to investigate. That might be a good door to come through, but you don't want to stay there. You want to move from investigation to adoration. In fact, before I prepared to make proclamation, I had to get me some adoration. That is, before I got here to Shiloh in my room, I turned on my iPod and I have my song, Come Thy Fount, Every Blessing. Tune my heart to sing thy grace. Streams of mercy ever ceasing. You see, I don't wait for you to help me worship. I worship before I proclaim. And before you really can get to know him, that's really the door you walk through, is you learn how to worship him. I'm not speaking of a cookie cutter method of worship. You worship however you worship, but you ought to not have to have anybody be your drum major to tell you to worship God. He's been good enough to you that all you have to do is think of his goodness and you would worship him. Nicodemus came on the grounds of misinterpretation, didn't he? He missed it because he came investigating an object rather than coming to worship the subject. Make sure tonight, whether it's I, your beloved pastor, those who stand in those classrooms before you, that in your privacy at home, sometimes in the car, but I don't recommend that. That could be hazardous to your health. Get to a place where you can honestly, authentically, with integrity, pause, not squeezing God in the day, carving out time for him and worship him. And if you worship him, you'll come to know him. We know that you're a teacher who comes from God. But do you notice that when Jesus replies to Nicodemus, that there is a idiosyncrasy in Jesus? That typically when you ask one thing, Jesus answers something else. That Jesus often answers the questions that you should have asked. He said, Rabbi, we know that you are a teacher come from God. No one can do. And Jesus, almost in literature, a non sequitur, he just bypasses what he says. And in verse 3, Jesus says, look, let's cut through the chase, Nick. And he says to him, I tell you the truth. This is the whole truth. I tell you the truth. No one can see the kingdom of God, except that God would be with him. And Jesus, it seems to be almost in the habit of answering questions that nobody ever asked him. He's invited to go to Cana, Galilee with his mother. They're just invited guests to a peasant couple's wedding. The wine runs out. And Jesus' mother solicits him to become the sommelier and says, hey, look, they don't have any wine. And Jesus almost in a tone of agitation and say, hey, mama, stay out of that business. You don't even know what you're really asking for me. And she says, be a wine waiter. And the next thing you know, Jesus is turning water into wine and not even addressing that and answering now that his time is about to come. In chapter 4, a five-time married woman happens to cross the sexual, religious, cultural lines and talk to Jesus at the well, and she wants to know, where do you worship at? That is, this is Jacob's well. Do we worship in Samaria or Jerusalem? And Jesus didn't say anything about geography. I used to think that something was wrong with the writers of the scriptures, because I couldn't find the logical line. Because if somebody asks you a question, especially loving, kind, tender Jesus, he's supposed to answer what you ask. And Jesus just skipped over that and said, if you drink of the water that I have, you won't need what you've been drinking anymore. And here, once again, he answers in a way, and he says, Nick, let me tell you something tonight. You must be born. That's what he says. Again, he says, in fact, if you don't, you cannot even see the kingdom of God. What in the world is he getting to, this born again, born above? Well, whatever it is, we know that it at least says that one thing, whatever born again means, it means it's out of here. That's what it means. But temporally, it means that there is something above us that breaks in on us and disrupts our lives and turns it around. It's not from below. It's above. It's not earthly. It's heavenly. It is not wrapped up in time. It is spatial. It's spiritual. Born again means that. And he says, and if you haven't had a disruption from above, you can't even see. I wonder sometimes if that's what's wrong with the church in this city down the street. Because I know it wouldn't affect anybody here, but I wonder tonight, is there somebody that would say, I know what's wrong with those blind people down the street? That is, they got religion, but no relationship. They know about the culture, but not the Christ. I'm just asking. And you got to be careful. You can live under that which is above to disrupt and change your life and miss it every time and not even see the kingdom of God. You heard in July what happened in Defiance, Ohio, Carl Kistner. His granddaddy had died. They'd been having his house for three generations back in the early 1900s. And his granddad had collected some baseball cards. And so when Carl was in the attic cleaning up the house because his granddaddy had died, he came across a cardboard box. I see some people recognize it. And thank you, because I didn't want anybody to think I was getting ready to make this up right here. And soot was over it. He blew the dust off, looked inside, and found these smaller than normal size baseball cards. The edges were pristine. Now, you could find these cards different places, but the color had been disfigured and the edges were warped and they'd been weather-worn and water-battered and all that. But these cards were almost in mint condition. He just put them back in the box, put it back under the dollhouse, and kept going. Well, his siblings got a hold of the box. They took it down to the card holder, and the people couldn't believe what they saw. What they found were these mint condition, smaller than normal size cards, and they had a couple of names that people recognized: Ty Cobb, Cy Young. And on guessing, these little cards would be somewhere in the value of $20 million.
for three generations, that family had been living under treasure and couldn't even see it. And some of us would come in here week after week after week under the treasure of the kingdom of God and miss it because we don't even know what we're looking at. Preach, Ralph West. Here it is. You see it every week. Every week on your street, two people live on the same street. Two people live in the same kinds of houses. They work at the same kinds of jobs. They eat the same kinds of breakfast. They come back to the same kinds of houses with the same kinds of families. But one sees the hand of God all day long. Another sees God's grace and mercy and protection all day long. The other, all he sees is eggs and bacon and poker and golf. And that's it. It's how you have been born from anew. And whenever you get to a church house and people don't see, it makes church hard. We ought to ask God tonight, make me anew tonight that I might see the beauty of your glory and the glory of your beauty. Nick, let me tell you something. You need to see. But see, when you don't see, you start stuttering and stammering and falling over. The whole idea of born again. You see, you're in church. Born again is non-threatening to most of you tonight. In fact, what you're saying is, you could have said this because this doesn't refer to me. I've been born again. We'll see in about 10 minutes. But here, you can stumble over it because what happens is, Nicodemus is about to trip over the obvious. Remember, he's a religion scholar. And so Nick says to Jesus that night, how can a man be born again when he's old? And the term that he uses is the term where you get geriatric from. Which means old Nick probably been down to the gerontologist. Long in the tooth, steps are short, feels his mortality, his finality. And he wants to know, how can a man be born when he's old? Can he push the delete button in the computer of his life and erase his past and start over again? Can he hit erase and write a new chapter and act like the 50 years have passed? The 20 years don't count? How can you undo what you've already typed into the paragraph and the chapter of your life? How do I get rid of all of what I've gone through? Nick that night had some good questions. He's raising some good stuff, by the way, because he's now theologizing. Because Jesus has upset Nicodemus, because Nicodemus knew that the Jews would say to a Gentile that you could be born anew, but you would have to be circumcised and then plunged in the water, and then you would be made new. But John the Baptizer had already excommunicated the whole nation of Israel when he said, I don't care who you are and how much Old Testament you know, and how many Sunday school classes you've been to, and how many hallelujahs you shout, unless you turn your life in the direction of God, you can't enter into the kingdom of God. Oh, Nick here is saying, now wait a minute, you can't tell me old? How do I back up in life? Can I go back and say July 7th? 2012, this is my new birthday, and I'm going to start all over again. And I guess Jesus said, now you being silly. But that's what happens when you start trying to be too intellectual and secular, and you got to rationalize everything. Because what he's really asking is stuff like this. How is that going to happen? How are you going to do this? How am I going to make any of these kinds of things happen? Tell me tonight, how are you going to, you're going to take this mind that has thought creatively and loftily, but also have been contaminated and polluted by what it has heard and seen? You can take my mind and make it real? My feelings. You can take my feelings, my emotions, emotions that have felt love, but now they experience hate. You can redeem them. My will. My will, you can take my will and do something with it. Tell me how you're going to do that. My self-image, what I had esteemed, but now it's been destroyed. That's why Jesus said, man, unless you've been born again, you can't see. And that's what's wrong with it. He can't see. And therefore, he's not able to encounter. If some of y'all here tonight, you can't see. It's like a man being in an art gallery talking about art, but ain't never been in the museum. It's like people talking about, I love romance, but all you reading is 50 Shades of Grey, but ain't never experienced real reality. You don't just talk about God. You have to encounter God unless you see. And here's what happens now. Jesus said, look, you got two IDs. You see it? That which is born of flesh is flesh. And that which is born of spirit is spirit. You see that? It's right there in case you think I'm making it up. I'm down at verse 5 now. He says, now, you got two IDs. You've been born, flesh is flesh, man. Spirit is spirit. Stop trying to make it more difficult than what it is. You don't have to be a Rhodes Scholar to understand flesh is flesh. Mama and daddy together birth a baby wrapped up in flesh. That's all it is, flesh. But Jesus is talking to the scholar, so the scholar knows that Jesus is talking about something more than just flesh. He's talking now about that which is gravitated and pulls down, that which is unimproved and unimprovable. There are those tonight that believe if I can just educate my flesh, if I can just culture my flesh, if I can give my flesh the right environment, I'll be all right. It ain't enough education in the world to redeem this stuff right here. No, I'm trying to help you tonight. And that is, you it's unimproved and it's unimprovable. And this is what you work with all the time when you meet people and they say, but ain't nothing wrong with me. I'm good and I'm nice. And you say, yes, you are, but you still all messed up. Because flesh is flesh. And that's all to it. Flesh is flesh. Spirit is spirit. Something has to happen from above to straighten out what's down here below. That's why when you meet somebody who has been born from above, you walk out first saying, now you know they ain't been changed. Because their life was so messed up that you feel like it's beyond redemption. Oh, but thank God, he specializes in people that seem impossible. I'm here tonight and I'm looking at some of y'all, and some of y'all, you grew up in church, but I can look at a whole lot of y'all. You just got to church and I ain't ragging on you. I'm celebrating with you. That is when folk thought that you were beyond redemption, the Lord says, I got a new identification tag for you. Flesh is born of flesh. Spirit is born of spirit. Flesh is unimprovable. You can't educate it enough. But spirit
Or when he get a hold of you.
You have to say nobody but Jesus. Have I got company in here tonight? Where somebody says nobody, nobody but Jesus. Listen, I'm going somewhere with this. Now here we go. You go to the zoo and you see a rhinoceros. It weighs a ton. It has a very small brain, 4 inches thick skin, dressed up in a Brioni tuxedo. And it stands back on whatever it stands on and starts belting out and sounding like Pavarotti. Now, I don't care how educated you are tonight. I'm talking about you for real right here. You are not going to say, you know, that rhino mother must have used to sing operas herself. I'm telling you, you're not going to say that. You're not going to say, you know what? I bet you their parents put that rhino in the corral to sing in its high school, and it went on to the musical academy, and look at what has become out of this rhino. If you and I go to the zoo and hear a rhino singing opera, sounding like Pavarotti, we know whatever happened, it happened from above. Come here for a minute. When you see a life that was twisted, corrupted, murderous, bigoted, racist, and it straightens up, y'all missed it. Because you think it's harder to teach a rhino to sing opera than it is for the Lord to redeem a soul. But I'm here to tell you, it's more difficult to redeem a person than it is to teach an animal how to sing, because the soul belongs to God. Preach, Ralph West. You think about your life. You know, I have to watch myself. The older I get, I like to just take off anywhere. Because I start thinking about how my life could have been. And I told you I was going to take it about 5 or 6 minutes for the people to say, well, born again, that's for somebody that don't know Jesus. No, if you've been born again, you need to ask God every morning, new mercies I see. I need the Lord to awaken me anew to his possibilities. Breathe real new life upon me that I may worship you afresh today. Flesh is born of flesh. Spirit, born of spirit. I'm through now. I'm going to tell you the truth. I could have been through. I've been trying to get to this one line. Because it's here and I'm through that Jesus gives the illustration to say, man, this is what new birth looked like. He said, this is what it means when you know that you've been born anew. And I guess, and I'm at verse 8 now and I'm through. And I guess that night when Jesus was talking to Nick, the wind blew. It may have been a warm zephyr that comes like off of the Caribbeans, or it could have been the hurricanic or the tornadic kind of wind of a Katrina. We don't know. Whatever it is, I just believe they was outside that night where nobody could see. And the wind started blowing. And he said, Nick, that's what it's like to be born anew. He said, the wind, you don't know where it come from. We've been out here talking for 25 minutes and we don't know where the wind is coming. It just showed up. And when it shows up, you know it's here. And I guess when he said that, that wind enveloped a leaf and got beneath it and started holding that leaf up and taking it. He said, you see that leaf? That leaf has no control of where it's going. That leaf has been caught up by the power of the wind. And that leaf, it can't wrestle itself out of the thrust of the wind. Nick, that's what I've been trying to tell you. If the wind get a hold of you, if the spirit start moving you, you don't know where it comes from. Oh, but also, you don't know where it's going. Some of you here tonight, if you stop holding on to the post and just lift your life up and let the wind get a hold of it, God can take you some places where you thought that you could not go. Have I got a company in here? Somebody here said, preacher, I'm standing tonight because I've been caught up in the wind. I didn't want to go to the left or the right, but I just said, have that own way, Lord. And when the Lord got through moving me, now I got to sit down because you can't control the wind. Now this is what has destroyed good church, is folk that try to control and conduct the wind. What makes the wind good is let the wind do what the wind want to do. Because sometimes the wind blow hard, but then sometimes the wind blows soft. And however the wind chooses to blow, just be there to be moved by the wind. For instance, I know some people that when the wind get a hold of them, the Spirit of God, the Hebrew Ruach, or the Greek Pneuma, or the German Geist, whatever you want to call it, when the Spirit gets a hold of them, sometimes they'll run around the building, get there and dance, shout. Ain't nothing wrong with that. But the Spirit might not move like that next Sunday. The next Sunday, he might just walk in soft and sit next to you. And all you can do is just nod your head. I don't want to be in church where folk trying to tell the wind how to go. I just want to get caught up in the wind. Do with me, Lord, whatever you want to do. Take me where you want me to go. Lift me and then sit me down. I got to sit down now. But my soul is getting happy. Now the wind blows where it will. Now that's the Spirit of God moving on your life. You don't know where it comes from, and you don't know where he's going, but he's always moving, ceaselessly moving. So get out the way and stop trying to control him. Let him do what he wants to do. Haddon Robinson tells this story, and I'm going to sit down with this, about Benjamin Russ, who was one of the signers of the Declaration of Independence. He was a medical doctor also, really in the field of psychiatrist. He described it as saying he felt like he had to minister to the disease of the mind. And one night, he had a dream. And in his dream, he saw a man climbing the steeple of Christ Church in Philadelphia. And he asked, as the crowd gathered, what is he doing? He said, that man is going up to wrap his arm around the weather vane because he's going to control the weather. And so when he got up on top of the church and wrapped his arms around it, it was there that he was going to control the weather, but things didn't work out according to plan. He would turn the weather vane one way and say, blow wind. And the wind would be calm. And then he would turn the weather vane another way. And he would say, rain, but the sun would come out. And then he would turn it another way. And then he would say, sunshine, but the rain would come. And vice versa, let the rain come and the sun would shine. And while he looked at it in the dream, Rush must have been quite a genius to interpret his dream in a dream. Because in the dream, he said he saw a messenger that looked like Mercury come to him with a placard and said, about you is this story. And it was at that moment that Rush got out of politics altogether, because in the story, he discovered that like the man in the weather vane, he was trying to turn people in the direction that he wanted them to go. And he discovered that all of the turning, all of the psychologizing was not enough to turn people where he wanted them to go. And when he woke up, he discovered that he didn't have to do a thing because that destiny wasn't in his hands. I got to sit down now, and I've enjoyed being with you tonight. But you stop trying to control somebody else's destiny and stop trying to control your own destiny. Get out the way and let the wind get a hold of you. I can hear Paul say it this way. Therefore, if any man be in Christ, he's a new creation. Old things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new. And then on this word here, I can hear old George Whitfield, the great preacher. He was out preaching, and Whitfield would preach, and he preached so many sermons, but he had one sermon that he preached over and over again. It was John chapter 3. And the name of the sermon was, "You Must Be Born Again." And you know, he preached it so much to one young man that had heard him so many times. Said, "Mr. Whitfield, every time you turn around in one of these revival meetings, you're always talking about you must be born again." He said, "Why do you preach that thing so much?" And Whitfield knew how to hoop, you know. And he looked at the young man and said, "Because you must be born again."
Looking for some inspirational gospel content? Just subscribe to Brother Rollins' YouTube channel today. We post the most motivational and preaching videos and gospel songs that are sure to get you through any situation. Even better, we have also launched a new apparel store that gives you access to a wide range of high-quality items. From awesome tees to hoodies, sweatshirts, mugs, and even tote bags, you can now proclaim your faith wherever you go and support our YouTube channel. Just visit the Brother Rollins YouTube channel and click on the store tab to shop now.